Welcome to this session about integrating a new publishing output in SDL Tridion Docs. Before getting into detail about the integration, I would like to refresh some of the publishing concepts available in SDL Tridion Docs. SDL Tridion Docs allows you to publish content stored in the repository. So authors will create topics inside the repository and reference inside the topic if needed, graphics which are also stored in the repository. These topics will get grouped into data maps to provide the sequence and the order in which they will appear in the final deliverable. While creating content, authors might decide to utilize conditions in order to write generic topics about a concept and reuse that topic in multiple publication outputs, which are more product variant specific. A publication captain using SDL Tridion Docs Publication Manager will say and state which versions to be used inside a certain publication version. So the publication captain will populate the baseline with a version selected for each included data map topic graphic. If the topics are using conditions, the publication captain can set up the context in order to make certain that the relevant pieces of information are filtered out from the generic topic and the not relevant pieces of information are hidden in that content, making certain that the generic topic becomes the product variant specific topic. Finally, he or she will create a publication output object, which in essence is the combination of an output format and one too many languages in which that output format should contain the information, and publish out that output format, publication output object. Triggering this publishing can be done in three ways. Either using the web client, so you navigate in the repository section towards the publication version of your liking. You select the checkbox behind one of the output format language combinations and you click the publish button at the right hand side. The web client allows you to trigger this publishing process for a single publication output at a time. Making use of Publication Manager will allow you to trigger the publishing jobs for multiple publication output language combinations in one click. So in the Publication Manager, on the Output tab page, you can select one too many rows from the table below and click the Publish button. These will trigger in the background task system the discrete and separate publishing requests for each selected row. The last way to start the publishing is by making use of the web service API, either from within your own code base or through the ishremote commandlet. The web service API does allow you to even trigger publishing requests across publication versions and is hence the most generic approach possible, but you can implement that generic approach in any of your own tooling if you like. Triggering publishing will register a publish background task in the background task system of SDL Tridion Docs, and it's important to remember this because this means that publishing in SDL Tridion Docs is actually a asynchronous process which is running unattended on the server. The publish background task will execute two major blocks of functionality, where the first one is exporting all of the content referenced by that publication version. So it will make certain, starting from your root data map, to export all of the topics and graphics referenced by the root data map or any of the sub data maps. It will use the baseline information to ensure that the correct version of each of these items is exported. And it will automatically replace all of the GUIDs by actual file names as they have been exported on the file system. So the end result of this phase is that you have a folder on the server which has file system-based data content that can resolve all of its links. The second big block of functionality is the publish plugins, as we refer to, and they allow you to change the content, to combine the content, and to transform the content in order to get into your final deliverable. We have three big blocks of potential actions in that publish plugins. The first one is around comparison, where we can first normalize your content, the old and the new version, and then build from the two exported sets of data the change tracked XML variations, which include processing instructions that highlight what is added or removed from the content. So in essence, we are exporting the files from an older version, from the newer version, and the comparison routine will mark inside a new variation of that file what was available and hence is deleted, or what was not yet available and hence has been inserted. The combine languages plugins allow you to group multiple languages inside one deliverable. For instance, a PDF file containing the English, the French, and the German information in one physical object. The post-process plugins allow you to act and handle, manipulate, massage your XML content before an actual transformation starts. In this case, or in our world, most likely Data Open Toolkit based, and find out whether that transformation did create your output. If so, upload it in the repository so it is available later on to download from inside our application framework, either the web client, the client tools, or even the web service API. The post-process plugins, as said, can be controlled by yourself. They are defining the flow and the actions to take to get from file system-based data into a final deliverable. And at the left-hand side, you see the easy transform, meaning straightforward, one version, no change tracking, no combination of languages into one physical file, but just getting from file system-based data into a PDF file based upon the PDF2 plugin type of Data Open Toolkit and uploading the resulting file into the repository. The right-hand side shows the more complex setup, which does support the comparison routines. So this one will allow you to build up change-tracked information and highlight and visualize the changes in the final deliverable. It also contains the configuration section about combination of languages, combined languages plugins, which allow you to group multiple languages into one PDF file. And then it will use the same sequence of XML transformation, massaging routines, and invocations of Data Open Toolkit, resolving the final generated file and uploading it into the repository. So the sequence element is shared between both, but for the each PDF trends type, the compare option and the combine languages options have been enabled as well. So how can you now integrate your own output? Let's take into account the following use case. We would like to extend the SDL3D on Docs environment with two new PDF layouts, one with the color scheme green one with the color scheme purple, which can be set through the output format dialog. We will show you as well how you can implement your own DataOpen Toolkit instance and or your own DataOpen Toolkit trends types plugins. And we will show you how you can extend the invocation call of DataOpen Toolkit from our tooling to include any argument of your liking that you would like to pass on to the DataOpen Toolkit for further handling inside. In this sample, it will be the selected color scheme value so that we know that the DataOpen Toolkit will use either the green or the purple color. So, starting situation of this use case, we have the following output formats available, where you see two PDF renditions. The final state, so after the presentation, we will have four PDF renditions available, and we will extend this list with PDF green, PDF purple as options. Extending the output format dialog and making certain that we can make the selected value persistent in the repository means that we have to extend the fields available in the SDL3D and Docs repository, and due to the fact that we would like to use an LOV, the list of LOV containers in order to allow us to control which color scheme values can be used when generating the PDF file. So in an XML setup methodology, which is a XML format expressing the LOV, sample color scheme LOV, with two values, green and purple, which allows you to express one-to-many fields, in this case, the sample color scheme field, which is a string field linked to the previously defined LOV, and which allows you to state where the field should be usable, in this case, the output format object, hence the card type CT output format. So this proprietary SDL3D and Docs XML structure allows you to introduce new fields, to change fields, to extend the LOVs, or extend the values of LOVs, and assign fields on different card types. Executing such an XML file is making use of the database upgrade tool executable with the option setup, hence the minus setup on the command line, and with two arguments, the application name, out of the box InfoShare author, and the path towards your XML file that you would like to get executed on the database, and hence the list of actions that you would like to see happening on the database. Executing this will show you the following output if all goes well with your script. It shows the part of the script that you executed, and it would list issues in case of errors encountered during the execution of that XML setup, or it will tell you that the script and the setup went successful. It will identify itself whether or not actions need to be taken, so you can rerun an XML setup script multiple times. It will just see what is changed and apply the change. As a result, you will see in the web client on the settings area in the list of values section a new color scheme LOV available with the two values green and purple. And you will see, using the isRemote get type field definition commandlet, that the new field is also available for the output format card type. So the database, the repository, has everything set up correctly. Of course, this does not yet include the UI. So in order to allow you to set up in an easy way the values and utilize the field on the output format, we have to extend the metadata config.xml file, introduce the new field, the color scheme field, and say how it should be presented on a dialogue, in this case as a pull-down, and the applicable values for the pull-down can be retrieved by utilizing the value list as we have defined, which will show all of the active values of the LOV. Of course, we have also to say where on the dialogue we want to visualize the field. This is done by adding the field reference to a group of the output format available groups, or to introduce your own new output format group and add it to the output format dialogue. In this case, we opted to add the reference in the Data Open Toolkit output format group, which already contained the custom customization directory field as well. Saving these changes in that metadata config file will result in a new visualization of the output format's properties dialog, where now the color scheme field is available and contains the available values from the LOV. So now any administrator can make use of that field when setting up output formats. Installing your own Data Open Toolkit instance to make use of the color scheme property can be done by either duplicating the existing InfoShare folder, which is available in InfoShare App Utilities Data Open Toolkit on the server, or by expanding a downloaded zip package from SourceForge of any Data Open Toolkit instance of your liking. You can create as many additional subfolders, as many additional Data Open Toolkit folders as you need underneath that location in order to set up the different variations that you need. You will need to copy some of the integration files, but we will come back to that later in the presentation. Setting up a new trends type, a new plugin in an existing Data Open Toolkit instance is just copying your plugin in a folder underneath the plugins folder of the Data Open Toolkit of your liking, in order to make the administrator able to utilize these new locations, the location of the Data Open Toolkit instance itself, or the trends type that you introduced with your plugin. In order to allow them to utilize those, you have to extend the metadata config XML file as well on two out-of-the-box field definitions. The first one is the trends type field, so the FDataOT trends type field, which contains an enumeration of all allowed and available trends types that can be used for output formats. So you have to extend that enum list with a new item element, which is a value label pair pointing to, in the value, the actual trends type as available in your Data Open Toolkit plugin. In the label, any readable representation of that trends type that will be used in the output formats dialog. In this case, I've used both my trends type for label and value. Similarly, for the Data Open Toolkit instance, in the field F style processor, you can add a new item that points to value label collection to point to the newly introduced directory on the file system containing the Data Open Toolkit instance of your liking. The value needs to be the accurate file path, so the correct file name underneath the Data Open Toolkit subfolder. The label can be any readable reference to make the administrator able to choose the correct value. The integration files that we need to have available in your new Data Open Toolkit instance are the four listed underneath the required files, where the ishrun dataot ps1 file is the file that the plugins will call upon to trigger the Data Open Toolkit process. The config custom, or helper files to make certain that the PS1 file is running with the correct setup, respecting the class paths and environment variables that the DataOpen Toolkit requires. The DataOT ish.html help.ps1 file, PSM1 file, is a helper file specifically for CHM. We also reroute the catalog.datatemplate.xml file to use the definition as used by the server when validating the content that gets uploaded. So we are single sourcing the same DDDs by rerouting the path inside the catalog.datatemplate.xml file to the path underneath web author ASP doc types. And by default, the ishrun.datot.ps1 file is triggered with the following arguments, or triggers the DataOpen Toolkit with the following arguments, but we will show in a minute how you can extend this. So in order to supply our color scheme value to the DataOpen Toolkit, we can extend the command line and call for DataOpen Toolkit with a new argument. So we can do that by either building a separated PSM1 helper file, which will help define our MyTrendsType-based invocation, and by including that rerouting in the ishrun.datot.ps1 file. Of course, you can do that directly in the ishrun.datot.ps1 as well, but for maintenance reasons, I show you the helper file triggering file approach. When the ishrun.datot.ps1 file is called, we automatically have a property available, which is the publish post-process context file location, that will allow us to look up some additional files like the metadata of the output format and the publication output object metadata. So building a script like this in my helper file that says I have a new function to run and for my trends type that will read from the output format metadata file my color scheme property and will populate that one with the -d argument towards DataOpen Toolkit for further processing in any template, any plugin available in that DataOpen Toolkit instance. So setting up this helper function and changing the outside ishrun.datot.psm1 file in such a way that we have a switch command that now verifies if the trends type is equal to my trends type to start my separated helper function and hence extend the DataOpen Toolkit call with the -d color scheme argument and otherwise trigger the out-of-the-box one, which contains trends type input, temp, output, draft, and log file. That's how to trigger DataOpen Toolkit, how to ensure Ant has got the correct items on DataOpen Toolkit. But the process is not yet finished. We have our own trends type introduced in SDL Tridion docs, my trends type. So we have to extend one of the post-process publish plugin sequences in order to know which steps to take. Otherwise, after the export phase, the tool stops and finishes and there is no file generated. So within the web client, the settings area, we have a section, XML publish plugin settings, available for administrators that allow you to create and extend a post-process element and introduce your trends type. In this case, I've added it to the same element as the PDF2 trends type, because my trends type is based off the PDF2 instance. And hence, it will, after exporting, execute these 7 plugins to remove not locked NAV titles, to check references, finally to run the DataOpen Toolkit, find the resulting file and uploading the PDF file of my generation process into the Data Open Toolkit, or into the repository. So once this file is saved in the repository, this extension, the additional trends type edition, everything is set and we can create our two new output formats, which either can be done through the web client, the settings area, the output formats section on the settings area. Again, the settings area is protected, so you need administrator rights to do so, or the ish remote commandlet in order to do it scripted and through the web service layer. Also there, the administrative rights check is done, and if you do or not marked with the user role administrator, the commandlet will not allow you to set up a new output format. So on the left-hand side, the web client approach, opening the dialog, populating the output format with a name, specifying the resolution, how the resolution should behave upon export, what the EDT will be, a PDF file in my case, which trends type, my trends type, which style processor, my customer, Data Open Toolkit, and I want to use green as the color scheme and the value for the color scheme. The right-hand side, the same approach through Ish Remote, where we first connect to the instance where we want to extend and create the output format, and then build up the metadata properties for the new output format, and finally invoke the Ish Remote call to create the new output format, making use of the properties. And in the properties, we have specified that we would like to use the purple color scheme value. Executing left manually and committing twice this dialog to create the object, or running the script at the right-hand side, will result in the availability of two new PDF output formats. So whenever the user now on the system wants to create a new publication output object, the available list of output formats is expanded with PDF green, PDF purple, and through the other items done during this session, the correct color scheme value property is available, read out, and passed along to the Data Open Toolkit to impact and influence the final delivered PDF file. Some useful links about all of these topics and the items that we touched upon. So on the docs portal, the specified section about SDL 3D and docs, you can find more about the XML setup structures, which allow you to set up new fields inside the repository, the metadata config XML structures, which enable and allow you to set up the visualization and the UI of the property in any location where you see fit. And if you want to implement your own post-process plugin, you can find the documentation of the post-process plugins interface and all of the concepts around it as well. So you could even override or implement your own processor in order to build up a final format like a PDF file, not making use of Data Open Toolkit, but making use of a complete different application with a different set of arguments to be supplied. I thank you for your attention and wish you a nice day.